Here in the Wellington room of Thursday. It's my pleasure to introduce Dave, great Irish guy, coming over to working for Red Hat in Brisbane now, working on all different flavours of different parts of the graphics subsystem. So thank you, mate. Please make Dave Airlie welcome.
Thanks, Paul. Today I'm here to talk about the Vulkan Graphics API and pretty much what it means for Linux users and Linux in general. I've been working for Red Hat now for about 10 years on very various things. We finally managed to convince Red Hat to join the Khronos Foundation, which is the group that makes all of the graphics APIs, like OpenGL, OpenGLES, and these things last year. And this meant I actually got to work on a standard before it became the standard, as opposed to fixing the mistakes after it became a standard. It was nice. But today I'm just going to give a quick overview of what Vulkan is, a bit of a comparison between Vulkan and OpenGL, and then I'll just go through what the current status of the Linux Vulkan drivers and subsystem is. But just a little digression. Before I came to the conference, I read, like an hour before, I read the you needed some way to get HDMI out of your laptop thing, because I naturally assumed VGA would still be here. And I built this from the parts in my in a box at home. So yes, it worked. I was pleasantly surprised. I have to hit the right button. Okay, so what is Vulkan? Up in the corner you'll see there's a little URL. That's the place where all the information on Vulkan is from Khronos. Vulkan is a next generation graphics API. What does that actually mean? It's not OpenGL++. It is not like they took OpenGL and went, let's just add more stuff to this. It's a from scratch, start again, low level, low overhead, cross-platform, modern graphic card accessing API. So it's, if you're familiar with the Windows world, it's sort of an equivalent to the DirectX 12 API that's also been brought up. It came from AMD's mantle. So AMD realized a few years ago that CPU overhead in their driver was causing them a lot of their problems, and they needed to get closer to the hardware and give more power to other people. So they started this mantle driver. As with all things, it didn't probably get great traction, but it gave a good base. And then they donated that to Khronos, and then all of the people in Khronos pulled it apart, made it work on all the other graphics chips, and shipped it out. It's been in progress for quite a while, but it's a very interesting model compared to the OpenGL model. I'll just give you a quick look at the sort of stack that's involved. So at the top there's an application, which isn't in the picture, but that's just a game. That's a small piece of code. It talks to a loader. The loader is across all vendors. Everyone uses the same loader code. The loader pretty much just takes the API, looks at all the graphics cards in your machine, and routes it to whichever graphics card you want. I think that's pretty much all it does. It loads the drivers and it loads the layers. The layers is a new concept. Layers are common pieces of functionality that you can plug in and out dynamically. So in Vulkan, I've given some example layers. These don't all actually exist yet, but validation, for example, is in a layer. So how you've got your API, you call things. All the error checking is meant to be done across all the drivers in one layer. No driver needs to do its own explicit error checking of all the API arguments, or what you've been passed in as sane, or if you're going from A to B, that you go through the right route to get there. You don't go taking shortcuts and stuff. You can also use layers for things like fixing buggy applications. So if an application is giving you bad shader code, you can rewrite it in the layer before the driver sees it. This means that every driver can, in theory, fix application bugs in one place, and it's shared. Other things like tracing. You can plug in a layer that takes every API call, pipes it out to a file, still passes it through to the application or to the driver. And another thing like default GPU selection, so you can load up all the drivers for all the graphics cards in your machine, and then the layer can be used to pick one as the first one in the list, which most applications will use. So it's a different model than OpenGL. In OpenGL, all of that layering stuff is in the driver, and in OpenGL, some of the loader is in the driver. So they've sort of tried to split it out so that we can get more common, trying to get more consistency between different drivers from different vendors. The validation stuff is pretty good. They've gotten a lot better. But the other thing that layers lets you do is you can turn them off. So you're developing a game, you're running it, you think it's working, you ship it, and then your users don't run the validation layer anymore, so they don't have the overhead of the validation layer. So their application CPU usage will go down, and this goes for most of the layers. You can remove them as needed. They're not all necessary. So it's good like that. You can reduce the CPU usage pretty much up front, just in when you're debugging and you need to turn it back on. And then finally, at the bottom, you have the drivers. These are called ICDs, installable client drivers, I think is what the term is. OpenCL has them. OpenGL sort of has them, but didn't do a very good job at them. But Vulkan does them properly. So in my world, mostly where I'm going to be working is in the driver. That's the driver that takes the API and steps into the hardware somehow. So that's just an overview of how to stack. One other thing that's sort of just important to mention, that's how do you check the conformance of this? Unlike OpenGL, the conformance testing in OpenGL was all hidden inside Khronos. Get accessing to it was hard. Vulkan, they've open sourced the conformance suite, so you can get access to it and run it on your driver without having to go through hoops and figure out things. All people should be contributing to the test suite instead of doing an own internal test suites, because that's another problem. You get a lot of vendors will have a massive test suite internally that they've never released. The idea is, yes, we'll try and get everyone to work on one test suite and make sure that consistent behavior happens across all of the hardware vendors. It's open source, but it's kind of thrown over the wall open source. The tests are usually developed internally in a Git repo inside of Khronos, and then once they're validated on everyone's hardware and everyone's happy that the tests are valid against the spec, they get released out into the open source on GitHub. It's not brilliant, but it's way better than what we came from. So the question is, why do we need a new 3D API? What was wrong with our old 3D APIs? Well, OpenGL is old. That's no reason to replace it, but it was, just to give perspective, released in 1992. The Mesa OpenGL implementation started in August 1993. So in about 24 years of development, it's done well. It's survived pretty well over those years, but computers have changed, how stuff work has changed, and the OpenGL design, did I lose my slide? Why have I got a blank slide in there somewhere? Oh well. So the OpenGL design has a problem. It was designed in 1992 for a start, and that was based on the hardware at the time. It has a very big state machine hiding inside it, and that state machine has just grown with new hardware and new extensions, and people add more things to it, and it just got bigger and bigger. There was a vague attempt to reset this about OpenGL 3 time. If you want to look at the history of that, that failed miserably. It wouldn't have been perfect, but it would have been a lot better than where we ended up. But due to the momentum at the time, people still wanted to keep all of the old APIs that were in there, doing all of the old immediate mode. I have to type everything in, you know, for every vertex one line by a time. It's sort of struggling under its own weight now, and it's gotten hard. So that's a lot of legacy functionality that hardware doesn't even support is in there now. So then you have to emulate that on modern hardware just to support some feature that maybe no one's even using anymore. But to get conformance, you have to get through this. If anyone's ever programmed OpenGL before, you'll be aware of the OpenGL context model. So you create a context, you do everything inside the context. When the context needs to send stuff to the graphics card is undetermined. You will do draws, and some of the times those will get sent to the graphics card. Sometimes they'll just sit in a queue. You can call GL flush when you want to explicitly do it, but you have no idea when it implicitly happens. It could implicitly happen at any time in the when you're building your context and putting your state out there. So it hides a lot of the GPU details from the applications. A lot of the control flow things are hidden from your application. You don't get to see what's actually going on. Sorry. The problems that design has caused. Having this single context thing makes multi-threading really difficult, because one of the rules of OpenGL is the context can only be bound to one thread at a time. But if you have no idea when that thread is going to be getting stuck into the hardware explicitly pushed down, it makes it really hard to run multiple threads in parallel with multiple contexts. The sharing model is really arcane, and a lot of the drivers don't always get it perfect. So yeah, you pretty much end up with a lot of OpenGL games are very limited to either a single thread, and the driver does a bunch of tricks internally to multi-thread it. But multi-threading the API is really hard, because the API has a load of, I'll give you a block of memory, and when you return from this function, I want to override it. So you have to copy a whole lot of stuff if you want to stick stuff into another thread. So there's a whole lot of, like, a lot of hacks in graphics drivers to try and get some sort of threading of OpenGL, just so it can use all of the cores on your machine, which, you know, we've had a lot of cores for a long time. Sharing the context isn't always reliable. It can be a pain in the ass, and you can bind something in one thread and forget to, and then things fall over. It's really hard to debug. Even another way, so OpenGL is also, the original OpenGL was always designed around a window. You had to have a window. If you wanted to render off-screen, they added these frame buffer objects later for doing off-screen rendering, but you still need to have a window. And then eventually it grew, you can maybe get rid of the window, but it's off-screen rendering isn't really native to the design at the start. So it's sort of been bolted on, and a lot of people want to do off-screen rendering. That's part of, you know, it's a thing that people like. GPU hardware has converged. When OpenGL came out, there was many, many graphics card vendors. Nowadays, at least on x86 side, there are possibly three. On ARM, five maybe, I suppose. But they're all converging on a similar model. They're all designing their hardware around OpenGL ES or OpenGL Direct3D. So there's not so much of the crazy offshoots with insane things that OpenGL needs to support or hide from you. So there's not as much need to hide the details of how the GPUs work from the applications. So this gives a bit of a comparison between how things look from OpenGL to Vulkan. You'll notice in the OpenGL side, the applications at the top, it's not huge. The driver is big. The driver takes care of all of the memory management, the error handling, the context handling. Can't read the small writing, but yeah, the complex drivers, everything's in the driver. That's where the complexity lies in a lot of cases. And it makes it kind of hard for us to evolve things because the drivers are so complex. The error handling is always active. There is an extension now to turn the error handling off. We haven't actually put that into open source drivers yet, but it's again a bit of a hack on top of things. It's just, oh well, we'll just try and get rid of this problem because we need to. The shading language, so GLSL, it's fully pre-processed. You have to get the GLSL shader into the driver, run like a CPP equivalent over it, and then do a full compilation. It's a C-level language. So there's a lot of flexibility in what GLSL expects and what way it should work. The spec isn't always exactly clear on what should expect. So but it's also very complex. So every time you get a shader, you have to pre-process it, and then this leads to complex caching models and ways of hiding the overhead of compiling and pre-processing the shaders, and again, more complexity, and further away from what the hardware's doing. But the Vulkan model moves a lot of responsibility back up to the application. In reality, it's probably not going to end up in the game. It's probably going to be more of a toolkit problem. So your Unity or your 3D or one of those source 2 engines, the engines are going to be the thing that takes the complexity, not really the application. I think most games will be sort of targeted still to run on GL and other things, but they'll have an option. But what does the application have to do? It has to take on the memory management, for example, is now the application's responsibility. The application knows how much video RAM you have, knows how much RAM you have. It needs to decide how to do things. Threads, the application can happily run as many threads as it wants, and it's in charge of those threads. It decides what gets sent to the graphics card when. There's no implicitness in it. It's, I wish to send this to the graphic card, send it. There's never a, oh, when you said that draw, I ran out of space, so behind your back, I sent it all to the graphics card and started again. That's all gone. It's, everything is explicit. Moving stuff between threads, giving different threads access to images, everything has to be explicitly stated. There's transitions all defined for everything. It exposes all of the hardware cues. So if you look at your standard Radeon graphics chip, it probably has one graphics cue, 8 compute cues, and maybe 2 DMA cues. In OpenGL, they're sort of all hidden, and the driver will use them if it feels like it, or maybe if the moon is the right size, it'll go, I'll just do this with DMA transfers today on this chip. But there's no way for the driver to, or for the application to control that. So if you know that the transfer path is faster, you can't influence how that gets used. So Vulkan gives them access. It exposes the graphics queue, the compute queue, and the transfer queue, and it lets you know what you're allowed to do on those. So graphics queues are generally allowed to do graphics. All of the 3D API, all of the operations are there. The compute queue is pretty much limited to just the compute operations, so it's usually a subset of the graphics queue. And then the transfer queues are limited to just moving stuff generally between images and buffers. Yes, there's a lot more for the app to do. Even a trivial app is quite an undertaking to write. A properly triangle drawing app is still a lot of work. But the idea is, by giving this power to the applications, we will reduce the CPU overhead, and we can use all of the threads on our 8-core chips, and everyone, games can get much faster. It's sort of similar to where consoles had gone over the last while. So consoles have had this sort of model where they've got a, you know, I think the PS4 CPU is weak, you know, but because they're designed around the GPU is powerful, we don't need that much CPU, we don't have all these overheads. It also enables other models that we couldn't do with GL. One thing that you may have heard of is asynchronous compute is a thing that happened with DirectX 12 and Vulkan. With AMD's graphics cards, if you were throwing stuff down the graphics queue and you weren't using all of the compute, all the units on the card, if you threw stuff into the compute queue at the same time, it would use the spare pieces that were left over the graphics queue wasn't using and do the compute jobs on them. So I think Doom was the first thing to use it, the new version of Doom on DirectX 12 and on Vulkan. And it meant that on AMD's cards, they could schedule a load of post-processing work when the game was running. So there was no, we have to wait for this to finish. It was so much faster to be able to utilize all of the bandwidth of the internal of the graphics card. I think even the latest NVIDIA cards have started to pick this up now as well. And they can schedule different things, interleave different things at the same time. So it's exposing a lot more of the power of the graphics cards to the application, as opposed to trying to hide them inside this OpenGL API.
Is that scheduling the driver or the hardware?
The schedulers, the good question, sorry, the question was if that's scheduling in the driver or hardware. It depends. There's, at least with the AMD Radeon, the kernel driver currently does the scheduling in parts, but the hardware has the capabilities as well. It moves depending on which GPU you're looking at. So just one area that's good to know about is, so I said GLSL is this big, hey, C processor. Oh, I need to actually run all this stuff just to make it into the binary I need. So they decided to address this problem by introducing a different sort of style of shading language called Spear V. It's binary formatted language. It's open standard. It's a separate standard to the Vulkan standard. It's also used by the OpenCL thing, and there will be OpenGL extensions to allow use it with OpenGL. It's if people are compiler or intermediate representation knowledge, it's SSA based, which means it's single static assignment, which is a form of representation that makes it easier to optimize things. So it's more like an assembly language thing compared to the GLSL C level language. If you've ever looked at DirectX, it's got HLSL at the top level, but when you go to the driver level, it's got this HLSL bytecode. And it's, again, it's in that sort of area. The idea behind this is you don't write shaders in Spear V. You still write your shaders with GLSL or HLSL, but you convert them to Spear V when you build your application, not every time you run your application. Yeah, so the idea of offline generating the Spear V and then giving that to the drivers. The drivers still have to compile it, and there is still caching. Again, the caching is explicit. The application is told, here's the result. You can build a cache. Here's a SHA of it. You know, it's all explicit. Again, the application can control the caching. It's not hidden from it, which in OpenGL, all the caching was all magic, and you didn't even know if it was there. Drivers didn't even have to have it. But the only way to make things fast was to cache things. So it's an interesting diversion. Spear V, it has problems like anything. It's not perfect, but it's a lot easier to work with at that level rather than having to write a C preprocessor. So what does that mean from my point of view when on Linux, from a driver developer, for somebody that wants to make Vulkan work on their graphics cards? Well, for a start, compared to writing an OpenGL driver on Mesa, like if you want to add something, all of the error checking had to be done first, and all of the tests for the error checking had to be done. We don't have to error check, which is a bit scary, and sometimes you still find yourself putting in error checks and then going, I'm probably not made to do this. The validation layer should be doing this. I should be doing this in the validation layer if it's not already doing it. Yeah, you'll still stick asserts in and things because you're writing code and you know crap's going to happen and you haven't done things perfectly. But yeah, it's kind of we're out there, we're going fast. So the command stream creation is explicit. So this is how the threading works out, instead of you going, I'm writing stuff, send it to the GPU, you go, okay, I wish to decide in advance what I'm going to write, and I'm going to tell you explicitly every single thing I want in this command stream, and it will build your command stream. And then when I am ready to tell the graphics card that I wish to use this command stream, I will submit it. And the submission is the only thing that is single threaded. That you have to submit your command streams in a certain order so that they get into the graphics card in the order you wish. But building the command streams is a big, it's a very CPU intensive job and so on. But with GL, there was so much overhead between what you got at the API and what you got at the command stream at the end. The overheads were too large. Whereas with this, you go start a command stream, you put all the startup data in it. The command says draw, you put this 10 bytes for a draw in it. You just build it up byte by byte or word by, it's probably word by word, I suppose. But it gives you a lot more control over how large the command stream. It doesn't actually matter. You'll just grow it till the application says, I'm finished. And then you record that, and that's static from then on. The whole way it builds pipelines, so there's a concept I haven't really mentioned, but if you look at OpenGL, if you've got a shader in OpenGL and GLSL, there's a whole bunch of other things you can do to affect the hardware or how that shader works on the hardware. So you may switch on blending and suddenly, or alpha testing, these are common features. You may switch those on, but the hardware has no native support for something like alpha testing. So how does the hardware do alpha testing? It hacks your shader and it adds a big bit of code into the bottom of your shader. And you get into this problem thing called shader variance, where you end up for every single GLSL shader you get from the application, you could be generating 20 or 30 different actual hardware shaders dealing with all of these cases. Some apps were good, some apps are bad. You get this crazy explosion that you can't see from the outside. So you've no idea how much time it's taking up, or when it's a slow pad, it might work on one driver, it might be slow on another. So Vulkan has recognized this as well and has designed a sort of a hierarchy of objects, but they're all static objects. So when you give the shaders to the driver level, it has all the information it needs to know to build the right shader. There's still occasions you might have one variant or two variants, but you have all the information at that point to build the one shader you need to make the thing work, which again cuts down on your CPU overheads quite substantially. So writing a driver for this is actually quite simple. It's a lot easier because it's very, okay, I have to do this thing. That means I have to put these bytes in the command string. This thing, these bytes. And it's just, you just do that a lot. And other pieces are slightly more complicated, but it is very quickly, here's the API, here's the command stream, or here's the API, that is in a buffer. There's no spending time messing around and figuring out what all the weird corner cases are. So as a driver developer, I quite like it. It made my life a lot easier. But, where did we go? So Linux support, where are we today? First of all, there are, of course, proprietary closed source drivers. I will give them a mention because they do exist. Not in my world, but other people live in the real world, I suppose. So you may come across these things. Stay away, no. But yeah, so of course, NVIDIA. Our NVIDIA, so NVIDIA have produced a binary driver for Vulkan. It comes as part of their standard Linux driver package. It still uses the loader and the layers and all that sort of stuff. I can't actually say much about it because I've never run it. So that's, but it does exist and it seems to be pretty good because NVIDIA do like to put a lot of effort into these things. AMD has a closed source driver. I think they launched it just after the launch date. It's part of their AMD GPU Pro package. They promised, and I always believe when people promise me things, that they will open source this any day now, a year ago. So, yeah, I'm sure they will, but I'm sure it won't be the greatest process in the world. I'm not sure how it's going to get open source. It might be a throw it over the wall. It might be a, we don't really want to take things from outside the company because how could you know how our hardware works type of attitude you get a lot with people. It's like, oh yeah, we are the only people that could ever design anything that could work on our hardware. You're never going to make it better. And then you send them a patch that makes it better and they're like, oh, we don't know what to do with this now. We haven't got a process. So it's up in the air. I'd loved to have seen this when I submitted this talk. I thought when I submitted this talk that I might have this driver by now, but I quickly realized that wasn't happening. But I'll get to what happened. But so when Vulkan released, these two drivers came out. But thankfully, keep doing that. The Intel Linux team, the guys who were responsible for the OpenGL drivers in Mesa on all of the Intel hardware, had stepped up internally in Khronos before the release date and actually had started working on the driver. So there was a team of, I think it was Jason Ekstrand, Christian Hoogsberg, I think was it Chad? Was it Versace? Those guys had done, and a bunch of other people, but the main three leaders were those. And they started this in working on this May 2015. They had I should have written down what date day one was. I have on my slides. I forgot to write down what the date was. But they had an open source driver on the Vulkan release day, and it was conformant with the conformance suite that was available on the Vulkan release day, which was very impressive. It was an open source driver written from scratch in Mesa, and it was more conformant than the AMD because they hadn't actually done conformance at that stage, and it was up there with the NVIDIA. So it was a really good example of how two or three, it was like three and a 3.5 people over 8 months, I think was the team size. It varied who came in and out of it, but how you could deliver something like that with a small team instead of hundreds of people and not deliver it at all. So it's an impressive piece of work. I'll get to a bit of a detail now about how it sort of works. If you look at this, you'll see these are sort of the components of what an open source Vulkan driver has ended up looking like, pretty much because this is how ANV worked. So why do anything different if it worked? At the top level, the two components that are, these are sort of the blue ones are sort of things that can be shared across drivers. So every open source Vulkan driver can take advantage of these. They don't have to, but it would be good if they could. The main thing being a SpearV, which is this the shading API to NIR, which is the internal one of the internal Mesa IRs. Mesa, because it's an open source project, has 5, maybe, or 6, 7. It has a lot of internal representations that we've drifted in and out of over the years. It's messy, but NIR is the one that the current Intel 965 driver and the cool people use in their backend compiler. So to share their backend compiler, it made sense, of course, that you would want to use the intermediate representation that led you into that. And also, SpearV is not a shading language that you would use. It's a transport shading language. It's not a transformable thing. It's not something you optimize directly. You need to convert it to something more usable. It's good for being a nice linear representation of things, but it's not good for, I need to swap these things around. So NIR is a much better platform for doing that with. So they wrote most of the code for that, the Intel guys at the start. Also, Vulkan has to interface to the Windows system. The native Vulkan native Vulkan standard does not have any Windows system interface in it. It does not contain anything. There is a set of extensions called the WSI, which is Windows System Interaction, I think, extensions. Those are what you use to actually display stuff on the screen. And so all that code, well, it should be the same because you're just talking to the X11 Wayland. I suppose I should say Mir. It's not there yet, but I see a Mir guy in the room, so I should mention that it is getting in the list. So we should share that code. There's no reason for every driver to get it wrong. So we'll get it wrong in one place and then work it out later. So the yellow piece then is sort of the core ANV driver. Every Vulkan driver, unlike OpenGL, in Mesa and OpenGL, you implement the API is implemented by Mesa. In Vulkan, there's no reason to have an abstraction layer between the driver and the API. So the driver just implements the API because you don't need all these grand abstractions. So the core of every Vulkan driver is going to be separate. Really isn't anything you can share in there. There might be a small piece or two, but I've looked through the ones we got and I was like, okay, getting the WSI code out is really good. That was the first task I tried to share. But the core driver, there's not a huge amount you want to share, so there isn't really much point at that level sharing it between, I suppose, disparate hardware drivers. The blue level is shared between hardware. The yellow is stuff I can't share, but then we have the other problem of, do we want to share with OpenGL? Because we have this OpenGL driver, it's got a compiler in it. We spent a lot of years writing that. That's a lot of work. Well, why can't we share that? Another area that's really messy on graphics cards is image layout. You think, oh, I've got this texture, but then you've got this texture with mipmaps, and then you've got tiling, and like the AMD graphics card, I think, has close to 100 different tiling modes. It is, you know, so you want some common library between your drivers so you can again make the same mistake in one place instead of making it twice and having to track down why 6 months later your Vulkan driver's got the same bug your OpenGL driver had 6 months ago. So the initial release of Vulkan did not share these as tightly. I think the compiler was shared, but the state library, they wrote a new surface tracking library. But now they've actually moved the OpenGL driver onto the shared surface tracking library. So this leads me to what I've been doing eventually. So RadV was kind of a spare time, not really a spare time. Red Hat has been kind enough to let me work on it and not told me to stop. But I didn't actually ask in advance that much. But back in about June, I think about 2 weeks after I submitted this talk, I went, okay, it'd be nice to have something to talk about. So I said, this can't be hard to write. It's I've seen the Intel one. I know what a driver looks like. This can't be that hard. So I sent an email, a private email, to a few of the developers in AMD, a few of the people who hang around on the Radeon list and do development outside of AMD and are just hobbyists that were interested. And a guy called Baz Niewenhuizen, I hope I got your name right, Baz, if you're watching this. He was a non-AMD contributor to the Radeon SI OpenGL driver. And he went, oh, I've been thinking about doing this as well for just a learning exercise. We'll just see what happens. So about a month later, I think the 20th of July 2016, so it was a month later, we decloaked our project and said, here's our working Vulkan triangle rendering driver. It doesn't do anything except render the triangle demo, but that's the start of all good graphics projects. Once you get a triangle, everything else is typing. So it's, we moved on then rapidly. Now, the thing about Vulkan is there's not a massive amount of applications. Dota 2, Talos Principle were the only other things we had at the time.
Triangle,
Dota 2. That's a big jump. There's a there are a few other demos, and I'll show you a couple of those, but they were pretty easy. But 26th of August, so another month later, for 2 months, we had a Dota 2 rendering properly. Like it was actually properly. There was no bugs in the rendering. The Talos Principle took us another month. So on the 27th of September 2016, we had the Talos Principle rendering properly. And that was just a, it was accidentally how I found the last bug. It was like I turned off something randomly and it went, hey, it's rendering properly, and turned it back on and it's broken. It's like, oh, this is a really stupid bug in the driver. But it showed how quickly you could get from nothing to, oh wow, I've got a game, like a game from Steam running. The 6th of October 2016, so I think we had used the Talos Principle as our, okay, we can put this in Mesa now, it's good. So we merged it to Mesa in October. And I have one other date here. It's the 23rd of December. We got Doom on Wine to run. It's not rendering perfectly, but it does run. I have played in Doom in Wine on my driver. So yes, it's quick. Getting a driver up was a lot quicker. And we have a benchmark from Phoronix, which not the most reliable site, but in one benchmark that he got running, we were faster than the AMD driver. So I didn't trust it, but I'm willing to take any win at this point. <It's like laughs> So yeah, it shows this is not an API that needs massive amount of work. Two guys did this. Since then, we were hobbyists. We were like, oh, we're just doing this. And like, I want to ship this, but if AMD came out tomorrow with it, we might abandon it and just take their one. We don't know. But not so long ago, Valve turned up and started asking me, can we help with this? And I'm going, why would you want to help two guys write a driver for AMD's graphics cards when AMD has teams of people who are willing to help you write a graphics card, a driver? I can't repeat their answer, but let's just say they are now, they've hired someone to work full time on this. So who had worked for AMD previously. So it's suddenly taken this very serious aspect to it. Now it's actually something people want to use, whereas before it was just something I like to work on, and it was something to ship, get knowledge. So it's, the model of the driver is not a hugely different from the Intel one. Same sharing at the top, the Spear V to Near converter, the Vulkan WSI layer. Radeon uses LLVM as its backend. The Radeon SI OpenGL driver uses that. We had to convert NIR to LLVM, so that's a pretty much one piece of the project. The other piece of the project is the Vulkan Rad V core driver. Then we reused the Radeon SI LLVM backend, and we reused the AMD's, they had an address library, which was the same thing, image layout, sharing, all that. So we shared pretty much the same, along the same lines of code as the Intel team. So, well, what can I run on this? As I said, Talos Principle, Dota 2, Doom. That's pretty much it, and a few demos. But there's more games. Game engines are starting moving. Unity 3D is out. We run its demos pretty well. And you can also soon, hopefully, cross my fingers, I don't have any dates for this, but we'll be running this, because I got one. Valve were kind enough to ship me one. I have been advising on what we need to get done for this to work. So far, I have looked in this, seen the moon, seen some stars in a static image, gone, oh, that's cool, I can see my controllers. I'd been looking at it on and off for like a couple of months as I fixed things and got it working. And then one of the guys in Valve built his system using my driver, looked in it and went, wow, it's all like noisy and weird. He's like, oh, there's a bug in our app. We'll fix that and ship it to you. And I was like, oh, wow, it's meant to look like this. I was like, I'd never seen it. I hadn't got a Windows machine to get it running on. I had to go out and buy a new computer just to get this running. Look, they shipped me to this, and I was like, oh, this isn't going to work on my little crappy computer. So, so the Steam VR stuff is a Vulkan-based rendering. So this is what will be happening in the future, and this is running. They are planning to ship, but I don't know why, and they don't tell me that sort of thing. But we are playing around with. Vulkan needs some extensions, needs some work to get this working, but we have implemented it. Last week, apparently, they have the Dota 2 viewer maybe running inside it, so you can. I have been off on holidays for the last few weeks, so I haven't actually had time to sit down and look at cool stuff, but it should be good. So that leads me to demos, questions. Demos is really, that's Vulkan running something. This is the ANV driver because I can't find a Radeon laptop I'd like to carry. But yes, open floor if anyone has any questions.
Thank you very much, Dave. Are there any questions? One here.
I'm just curious, differences between Metal and Vulkan from your perspective.
One thing about it, I said it was cross-platform. Yeah, it's Android, Windows, Linux. Windows 7, 8, and 10, which is different from DirectX 12, but you'll notice it's not macOS, because Apple have not shown a huge amount of interest. Vendors can ship this on macOS, but from Metal's point of view, it's a similar type of API again. It's a low-level, close to the hardware, no overhead API. It's interesting to see Apple go their own way on this. I think it's one of those time will tell whether that was a good idea. Sometimes Apple makes those decisions, it's good. Sometimes it makes them, it's bad. But there are going to be Vulkan to Metal converters, Metal to Vulkan converters. It's not, the APIs are not that drastically apart. I think Apple really wanted Metal because of more of integrating it with their Swift and their own ecosystem and their own, you know, compilers and that sort of thing, APIs, and make it more native on their OS. But yeah, time will tell whether Metal was a good plan or whether they should have just consolidated, gone with everyone else.
I know it's not quite your area, Dave, but I was just wondering, you mentioned Android and like what the situation of it is and things on ARM in general.
There are closed source ARM drivers for this, Qualcomm. Mali. I think Qualcomm and Mali are the only two. But on Imagination Technologies. So there are, but nothing open except for Intel. There are the Qualcomm, the Adreno project, Rob Clark, who's works on my team at Red Hat, he's contemplating it. Nouveau project, being it's only Ben Skeggs mostly and a couple of other guys, he works in my office. He really, really wants to write a video driver, the Vulkan driver for Nouveau, but it's a scheduling problem. He has a lot of responsibilities in the kernel in other ways. So we're trying to get him freed up to start on it, because someone else could do it, but he really, really wants to do it, and I'd hate to take it away from him just because he's gotten stuck with something else.
Cool. Any more questions? No? Yes, one there.
The shift to Vulkan affecting the difference between open drivers and closed drivers in terms of performance?
I think it will definitely reduce the gap a lot more. We've already reduced the gap in a lot of cases. The AMD's GPU, open source GPU driver, OpenGL driver, is pretty competitive now and beats their closed source driver. NVIDIA is a bit harder, but there's a lot more things going, harder to get support. AMD does write both their open source and their closed source driver, so it helps that. Yeah, but I think it reduces a lot of the overheads, a lot of places for drivers to hide or hardware to hide. The corners are all exposed. There's only really one way to do things, and you will be fast. Like I suspect, I haven't proven that the reason we're faster than the AMD's driver is because they've heavily abstracted something internally, and they're just chewing more CPU doing that thing that's just moving stuff between layers that are unnecessary, where we've done no abstraction. It needs to get straight to the, as quickly as possible. So I think there's actually a chance that open source driver will be more maintainable and faster in the long term with this, and a lot easier to get there. The big problem is always the compiler. The compiler's hard. I'm not a compiler guy. I look at LLVM and I cry sometimes. But it's an interesting thing, but I'm not wired to understand the intricacies of how to do schedules and compiler stuff. I can do fix bugs. But. So the hope is that the AMD's OpenGL and AMD's open source Vulkan may also go towards the same compiler, and hopefully that the LLVM AMD guys will make that compiler so brilliant that it won't matter what, you know, it will make my driver faster overall.
Cool. So with something like this, whenever we go through a change in driver technologies, it shifts the benchmark of what hardware you need. Where does something like Vulkan sit in terms of generations of hardware?
That's a good question. Actually, I forgot to address that. And this, the baseline for Vulkan was OpenGL ES 3.1. We're cut off. But OpenGL ES 3.1 hardware was where you had to, was where it should work. In terms of Intel, I think that's Ivy Bridge and above. With AMD, it's all the GCN cards. So nothing like in the Evergreen era. So 7,000s and above. And in NVIDIA, I think it's Kepler and above. So, but anything that could, in theory, do OpenGL ES 3.1 could, in theory, do this, but we're not going to go nuts on making it run on old R600s and things like that.
Lightweight socks.
Oh, in the socks, yeah. Anything that can do GLES 3.1 in the socks, it can do Vulkan. There's a lot of optional pieces with Vulkan. You don't have to do all of them to get conformance.
Cool. We're a little over time, but thank you very much, Dave. Excellent talk on behalf of the organizers of LCA. Would like to give you a gift. Please thank him once again.